and if you would care to join us in singing Day by Day, it's in your program. Thank you.
I think we all kind of know this, so
let's enjoy.
Today, this afternoon, to remember the life, both temporal and eternal, of Erik and of Erik and Leslie's parents, and Reverend Carolyn Perrault and her former husband, Paul Eugene Perrault. Reverend Caroline, of course, has lived in our hearts because she's been a devoted member of Center for Spiritual Living. She was born August 8th, 1934, and made her transition on December 18th, 2023. We're also celebrating today the transition of Leslie and Erik's father, Paul Eugene Perrault, who was born on the 29th of October in 1930 and made his transition earlier this year on March 20th. And so Erik really wanted to remember his dad as well at this service. So we release what was, and we make room for what shall be, and we testify within our minds that life does not end, but merely transmutes, and that today we say goodbye, and yet we also say hello. Through the grace of God, the dead do not die, they live forever. And as Ernest Holmes wrote in this thing called life, the word infinite alone, with all it implies, is adequate to explain it. Our place in life is to become an outlet for wisdom, for intelligence, for love, beauty, and creativeness. And some part of all of us exists as pure and unmanifest spirit, and Reverend Caroline's spirit truly grew to embrace that. So our service today is twofold. We're here to release what's been, the very human drama of our love for this woman and shared stories. And we're here to acknowledge Paul Perrault, Reverend Caroline's first husband and the father of her children. And since there was no celebration of life service for him when he passed away in March in Canada, Erik really wanted him acknowledged here today. And while the focus will remain on Caroline, a part of the service will be to acknowledge the very significant role he played in her life, in her ministry, and in the lives of her children. So we open our hearts today that our relationship with Caroline might be reborn through the grace of God, and that no one and nothing can take away that life, that eternal life, and that whom God brings together in all eternity, God, we know, is more powerful than death. And so we begin with an invocation and song. Aaron McGowan has written this lovely song. It's in your program, very simple. It's Wherever I Am, and that will be followed by Leslie Willis lighting the candle. So, Mother, Father, God, of unfailing love, we pray for the spirits of Caroline, our beloved sister, mother, minister, and friend, and may her spiritual homecoming be beautiful and peaceful, for we are the beloved people who mourn her and know that the glorious angel of God now ties the golden cord of eternal life to Reverend Caroline's heart, and at the other end, to the hearts of everyone here to celebrate her life. We know this, too. This eternal life is Paul Perrault's. So uphold us in our sorrows, surround us with love, and allow us to release these loved ones. Cause us to know at depth that we may see the truth of the world of the Creator, that there is no death, that Reverend Caroline and Paul Perrault still live, and in spirit, they are one with the life everlasting that is God. And so it is. Amen. And so Lucas Smeraldo has written a beautiful poem called Chinook that is dedicated to Reverend Caroline.
Thank you, Reverend Francis. And I want to let the family know that I've made some copies of the poem so that I will leave those with you whenever you're ready to receive those. This piece is called Chinook. The wind has no master, no dominion, although it answers to its naming, and the people who know the name know the song. Erik knows the song. The Chinook is the song. The Chinook are the song. The song runs along the rivers here and cannot be named without its permission, and so despite our best attempts, we will never name Caroline. Never take her song, but only sense her yearning, the warm and dry gusts that shake at the ankle boots of the common traveler. She was always going places, daughter of twin competing forces, carried forward at a cost, and with the promise that the whole line must bless and bear. And here we are today, reconciling her reach. Caroline wanted to live 500 years. She had so much ground to cover, a greed of curiosities and the wind in her nature. She is the restless grace. She is the spirit on the water. She is the name that can't be named, but must be sung.
Now our lead practitioner, Mona Williams, will read from Ecclesiastes and then from Ernest Holmes. Thank you, Luke, for that beautiful poem.
Kaddish from Ecclesiastes. To everything there is a season, a time for everything under the sun, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to laugh and a time to cry, a time to dance and a time to mourn, a time to seek and a time to lose. This is the time we remember those who gave meaning to our lives. This is the time we remember the love that we shared and the memories that remain with us all. Now I'll do a reading from Ernest Holmes. I was told to live by some inner mystic presence. I was told to live and to love and to laugh and to be glad. I was told to be still and know the one almighty power in and through all. I was told to let that power work through me and in me. I believed that voice. And I received my good.
So at this time, we're going to receive some reflections from Carolyn and Paul's children. And we'll start with Leslie. Leslie, you can either use this mic or this one up on stage.
These last few weeks, I've been thinking, remembering little vignettes of our family life that, upon reflection, my mother and father were both quite exciting people. I mean, when I was a kid, of course, they weren't exciting. They were mom and dad, you know, clean your room kind of thing. But they lived such varied and wonderful lives. They had many, many relationships. And then I remember we were a family of non-smokers, basically. So we're riding in the... And my mom and dad were campaigning for the mayor, as you'd read in the program. And so dad and I were riding in the back of the police chief's car. Dad was actually up front with him. I was in the back. And the police chief offered him a cigarette. And much to my shock and dismay, as only a 13-year-old or 14-year-old can have, dad accepted and smoked it. I thought I was going to die. But he later told me in the Navy, when he was standing for our watches, there was absolutely nothing to do, nothing to see, so you smoke cigarettes to pass the time. Okay, that was a shock. But when I was in high school, I had to take home ec. Hopefully none of you had to do that, because it was not a fun class. But part of it was we had to cook, and I didn't like the teacher, because I was a sloppy cook, baker, whatever. I just, you know, make the mess, do the thing, and then clean it up kind of person. She didn't like that. You're supposed to clean as you go kind of thing. And then we had to sew, and the sewing machine we used was almost like the original Singer Sewers, where you had a treadle and you had to push. This one, you pushed your knee against something, and sometimes it would go, and sometimes it won't. Makes it hard to sew. So anyways, I was talking to my mom, saying, I don't like this teacher. I do not like this class. She is, you know, it wasn't what I wanted to do. So bless mom's heart, she got all dressed up, came to school with me to visit the class, to talk to the teacher to see if she couldn't smooth some things out. Of course, on that day, a substitute teacher was there because the teacher had called in sick. So she had a lovely discussion with the teacher, as it was. But I dearly love my parents. It's sad that I don't think I told them that often enough. Sometimes you have to lose them to understand how much you really appreciate them. So hopefully they know. And thank you. Thank you for coming.
My mom had an incredible sense of humor. This was her Halloween hat. She actually wore it. I tried to put it on. It's really hard to actually juggle it and make it stay on. But
it's time to trick or treat. Up and down the scary street. Candy bars of every size. Lots of treats, good stuff inside.
So that was a big part of Mom. She's is such a huge array of stuff. And I don't know, I'm trying to collect my thoughts here. I've been running this endless, basically a 3-month marathon, and hardly had time to breathe, much less think. But the thing is that ultimately, she became a pretty extraordinary person. She didn't start out that way, but that's what she transformed into. It's like a caterpillar turning into a butterfly. And it's difficult to talk about some of the things of the caterpillar that she was, but I can tell you that she made a remarkable transformation, absolutely remarkable. Every bit as remarkable as when a caterpillar turns into a butterfly. I mean, just an enormous transformation. The person I grew up with as a mother is not the person that she became. She became this incredible person. And the Center for Spiritual Living, back then, it had a different name. It was called Religious Science, but it's the same organization, same teachings. And that had a huge role to play in the person that my mom became. And she was involved in so many things. She was out there helping and of service in every way that she could. She was involved in Street Links, which is an organization that was trying to help homeless teens. She was on a crisis line. She was a volunteer on a crisis line. She made baskets. She made ceramics. She made jewelry. Just on and on. Lots of extraordinary things that she did. She organized the Boeing had a disaster, what is it called? Disaster response organization that the employees, versus the actual firemen, they had this thing that basically she put together that was to do with disaster preparedness in case maybe there was an earthquake or something like that. And she was involved in that. And one of the things she loved to do was that every year they would have a an exercise with a simulated disaster. Somewhere there's like some broken rubble to simulate a building that had collapsed. And so they would dress up the volunteers, my mom being one of them. They'd dress them up with like a broken arm, broken leg, whatever, and then go hide in the rubble. And then the actual fire people, emergency response people, would have to go find them and rescue them and treat their injuries. And she loved doing that. She was always talking about that. So, you know, it's just, I don't know, it's hard to talk about the whole of it. But our family is really rather extraordinary, too. I was telling Frances our family history, and she says, oh, my gosh, you should write a book. You know, we started with a shipwreck in roughly somewhere around 1821. What we know about the Graves family line started with a shipwreck. And they were wrecked on a place called Dutch Harbor. You've probably heard of it. And it's one of the Aleutian Islands. And they started out in St. Petersburg, Russia. Two 16-year-old newlyweds started out in St. Petersburg, Russia, and went on an expedition to colonize Alaska. And they never made it to Alaska, which was probably just as well, because there was a lot of fighting between the Russians and the Indians, and most of the Russians actually got wiped out. So they were probably better off being on Alaska. But oh my gosh, a desolate, cold island trying to eke out an existence with almost nothing. And they did, they survived for like five generations, something like that. And then my great-grandmother was born, and she married a fellow who then took her dog sledding all over Alaska, panning for gold. And then after that, they moved to Kirkland, and then it was more conventional at that point. But the other aspect of it is that Olga is half Chinook Indian. So I have had some interest in Indian culture and have pursued that a bit. So later on, I'll be singing a traditional song. I think I'm going to leave it there. Just as a footnote, sort of a segue, one of the things Mom was involved with is this fun social group called the Red Hat Society. And this was actually one of her red hats. And now that I've shown it to you, I'm going to be giving it to them, and it can find a new home. So I think I'm going to leave it there. There's, you know, I've spent many sleepless nights trying to figure out what I'm going to say, but I think I've probably said enough. All right.
So Gail Embley will speak for the cousins of the Graves side of the family.
My name's Gail, and I am John and Maurice Graves' daughter and Caroline's niece. Caroline and John, brother and sister. I'm here on behalf of our beautiful family there. You can meet them all later downstairs. My dad spent his 30th birthday waiting for me to be born. He is June 7th. I was born June 8th, but 3 minutes after midnight. And it turns out that my aunt's birthday is June 8th also. And so in our adult years, we spent many, 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 many fun birthdays together, and always thought it was very fun that I shared her birthday with her. It was something special. I just have a few little thoughts. I'm not really used to talking in crowds except on an airplane. I'm a flight attendant, so there's no seatbelts to buckle. I do know where my nearest exits are, though, so. Slow me down, Lord. Ease the pounding of my heart by quieting my mind, steady my hurried pace. Give me calmness amid the confusion of my day. Break the tension of my nerves with the soothing music of thy love that lives in each memory we have. Teach us the art of taking minute vacations to pray for a friend or family, to look at some beauty of nature, which Caroline loved to do. Help me to realize there is more to my spiritual life than speed. Let me look upward toward the branches of the towering oak and remember that it grew great and strong because it grew slowly. Slow me down, Lord. Often we cannot bear the sorrow of pain, losing our loved ones, or the frustration of enforced time off, which seems so distressing and unfruitful. Yet we need these profitable slowdowns to develop the grace of patience. Recently, I took a walk with my Aunt Caroline in December. Not really a walk, but a spirit walk. I went to visit her before Christmas, and she was in a bit of a funk trying to sort jewelry and treasured items, and I helped her sort some of the treasures that she had wanted Joni, my sister-in-law, to have, and my sister Nancy and I to have. And so I reassured her that I would take her bundle of tangled things and fix them for her. And we had kisses and loves, and I brought her a little present, and I rubbed her back. And then we decided to go on a walk and found ourselves on a beautiful grassy knoll. She wasn't in pain anymore. She was walking, we were holding hands, and we laughed, and we walked down the hill. We both loved the water. We both loved nature. Her most beautiful crystal blue eyes, everyone knows Caroline's beautiful blue eyes, were sparkling. And she goes, "My brother, your dad, loved the water." "I know, me too, Auntie." And she nodded, "Me too, niece." And as we grew closer to the water's edge, we could see the crowd of many, many loved ones, family and friends, church folks. You were all there. You were gathered at the top of an amazing dock, newly constructed, apparently glistening new pilings and boards leading down to the most amazing ship that I'd ever seen. And I grew up in the water with sailing with my dad, and I've done lots of sailing with friends, but this ship was amazing. Family and friends called out, "Caroline, Caroline, Caroline, we love you. Have a fabulous trip." And she smiled and waved and greeted each and every one of you, all of you. Then she stood and smiled and waved and strode down the dock, her beautiful blue eyes tearing a bit, and she walked down the dock and boarded this magnificent ship. The ship released its mooring and took off. The sun was setting. Folks watched until the ship sailed into the horizon and could not be seen anymore, and tears were wiped from eyes, and folks dispersed. But as the magnificent ship sailed into the sunset, it arrived on the other side, a beautiful sunrise. I lost my place. Oh, here it is. The ship also appeared on the fantastical sunrise. The sun was rising and the ship sailed onto another dock. And as it reached the dock, another fabulous brand new dock, and Caroline saw another crowd, and they were waving and crying out, "Caroline, Caroline, we've been waiting for you. Welcome. Give us hugs. Come to us, precious Caroline." And she sees her brother, my dad, and his wife, Maurice, my mom. She sees her beloved husband and the beautiful father of her children and her parents and friends and cousins and aunts and uncles, and they are all shouting, "Welcome, Caroline. We are so glad you are here. You are so loved. You are home."
And now Sharon Sterling will present a tribute to Caroline. Sharon was instrumental in providing compassionate care to the family in so many ways. So thank you, Sharon.
So it was my privilege to know Caroline for probably about 9 years when I started coming to CSL. And then the last 2-3 years, I got more aware of her and better friends as I helped her in various ways with physical and medical challenges that she was going through. And that was a privilege, and it was a joy to get to know her in a closer way, and I miss her. I miss her. It was really a privilege to go visit her on Sunday afternoon, December 18th, when she was taking her last breaths, and I just stayed with Erik and her. And having worked in hospice for 15 years, I was very comfortable doing that. And she was so peaceful as she just, the air just kind of left. And her spirit, you could just feel that kind of rise up. And Erik was quite a trooper. I must really hand it to Erik. I don't know how many of you have ever been responsible for taking care of somebody 24/7, but it's a big deal. It's a really big deal. Erik was such a trooper in that. You don't really have your own time. And I supported him as best I could. And so I got to know Erik better too. And that was a privilege and a blessing in my life as we continue our friendship. as Erik and I were gathering things and bringing things for the memorial service, I came across this little box that she had a lot of her sermon notes in, and then some things were handwritten. And so I thought, ooh, this is some pretty cool treasures. And they were treasures of the heart. And that's where she was the richest, was in her heart, in her interior life. And so I wanted to just share a couple of those thoughts that from that box with you from Caroline as her thoughts to you. One of the handwritten ones said love on it. And then she had the acronyms for love. And so for the L in love, she had life. And, you know, a central part of her life, she had a passion, I mean a big passion for books, which was demonstrated with 6 big bookcases and about 4 or 5 smaller bookcases. And she was an avid reader and learner and growing in every way. And she had books that were spiritual. She had books that were on how to think and grow rich and on positive beliefs and abundance. And her abundance was so evident on the interior side. And that's really the greatest riches we can have, is what we are inside. And she loved to share those things of her interior life by sharing visioning and teaching classes. And she was such a vivacious person. And since I only knew her in the last chapter of her life, I was so glad to hear some of the really energetic things that she did. She told me some of them. But sometimes when you're not feeling real good, you just want to be quiet too. So I always applauded her for making the best of what she had. And the O in the love is, she had written as originality. Is there anybody more original than Caroline? I mean, really. Yeah, her artwork showed up in her kitchen. She had glass doors, and she painted them blue and then just had little outlines of an owl on them. Imagine that. And she did the painting. She did basket weaving, jewelry. She was just overflowing with energy and ideas, and it was original. It was all original, and she valued people that did original things. And that was a beautiful, beautiful thing. The V in love, she said, stood for values. And she valued experiences. I mean, her travels, oh my gosh, as you read in her bio, my goodness, she did a lot of travel. So we had a very kindred spirit there. She also did a lot of internal traveling of her soul. And I love the poem, or the thoughts, the story that you read, Gail. That was just beautiful. She valued learning and helping others learn and grow, and she did that a lot with visioning, teaching visioning classes that we have here at the center. And the E in love stood for expression. She expressed herself in all the ways that we can, that we've talked about, and they were so original. Her prayers were very original and expression. If you ever had her pray with you, you knew how rich she was inside. And she loved to share her riches with you. Her love was expressed in words, thought, art, beauty. One of the little things she had in her thing about the four letters of love, she had a quote from Ernest Holmes saying, "Love is the sole impulse for creation. The man who does not have love as the greatest incentive in his life has never developed a creative instinct. Love is at the center of man's being, and no one can swing out of the universe without love." And so I thought she exemplified that totally. So I will miss Caroline, but I think of her, and I can still talk to her. Thank you.
And now, Queen Gretchen of the Shades of Ruby chapter of the Red Hat Society is going to present their memories of Reverend Caroline.
Hello, everyone. Hello. I'm Gretchen. I'm an ambassador of the Red Hat Society, and I'm also Queen of the Shades of Ruby chapter, in which Carolyn belonged. And we just loved having her with us. Her sense of humor was amazing. She would get us all giggling, and we had jokes and all kinds of things. One of the things I give my ladies when they join my chapter is what we call a ruby bag. And it is a gauze bag in which we have things like bubbles to blow, blowing bubbles. So when we let our inner child out, we could play. And we would chase bubbles around the yard or whatever. And Caroline loved that. And we also have those little clappy hands things, you know, you shake them and they clap. That's something else we use to applaud each other when we have wonderful, amazing things happening to us. And she loved to shake those things like crazy. And our wax red lips, because Red Hatters hug each other. We're huggy people. And we give air kisses. And we have to do air kisses, otherwise our lipstick would just, you know, disappear. And so we have red wax lips that we wear, because that way we can give bigger air kisses. And we don't have to keep replacing our lipstick all the time. So, and these are things, little things in our chapter that Caroline just loved. She really got into it. She was amazing. But she had so much else in her. Sorry, I do miss her. Each of my ladies has something really special. Only the three of us could come today. But first is my vice queen, Barb, and she's going to tell you a little bit about what their heart's connected with.
Oh, you're there.
Yeah. Hi. I don't usually do public speaking, so bear with me. Caroline broadened our minds on her month as a princess planner. We went to art exhibits, the history museums, and any other historical places. There was a little cabin in Federal Way that we went to and had lunch on the benches. Caroline told Gretchen that she was worried about being forgotten. She isn't, not even with us. And thanks to Erik, we've acquired some of Caroline's pieces from her Red Hat collection, and I wear this one today in her memory.
Hi, I'm Shay, and I also don't do a lot of public speaking. I didn't know Caroline as long as these other ladies because I joined the chapter later. And I will say, when I first heard there was a reverend in the chapter, I was about ready to go the other directions because I hadn't met any that really walked the walk. Caroline taught me acceptance, to accept everybody as they are. That and the fact she always had some great recommendations for books, and I'm an avid reader. Thank you.
And this is what we say. I simply traded in my red hat for angel wings. Here I go. Please don't weep for me, for I know you all cared for me dearly. Farewell for now, my special friends. Keep your candlesticks burning brightly until we meet again. The items that Caroline had for red hatting that Karen and Erik graciously let us have been donated to other Red Hatters who cannot afford or find the purple that we wear and the red on our hat, on our heads. And they are extremely grateful, Erik, for having those items. We ourselves, our chapter, did keep a few of her items as well to use and wear in her memory. And they will be used. She will not be forgotten.
Wow. I remember some Sundays, Caroline would come to church with her big red hat because she was going to a Red Hat Society meeting after church. So that's beautiful. Are there any friends or others who would like to share at this time? Yes, Erik?
So I'm going to cheat a little. It's open mic, so okay. I remembered some things that I'd wanted to say. And one of the things, clearing out Mom's house was just this incredible project. Based on the number of boxes of books that we packed, and I also wanted to say thank you, huge thank you to Leslie Willis and Sharon Sterling. I could not have done it without you. And also Leslie, my sister, and Peter. They helped a lot too, but oh my gosh. I estimate that Mom had somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000 books, and I got to sort through all of them, and it was a huge range of topics, just anything you could think about. But the other thing, though, that I forgot to talk about is my dad. I mean, that was a big part of the point, was that I wanted to say something in honor of him, because he was a pretty remarkable person in his own right. And he's very creative. He's painting, sculpting, ceramics. He does electrical design and mechanical design, and just a lot of stuff. The only problem was he was so busy, he wasn't around very much, but he was very inspiring. and I hope that I can be more like him. So, okay, thank you.
So is there anyone else who has a burning desire to share anything about Caroline? If not, we'll move into a Chinook poem in song that Anjali Silva put to music. And it's a lovely poem that Erik gave to her, and she graciously spent time in developing the music for it.
Hello, everybody. Hi. I know a lot has been said about Caroline. Caroline, for me, was an elder. I'm gonna cry. I'm a big crier. She was an elder in my life where my elders had already passed. And I connected with her spirit. We didn't talk much, but I would just sit with her in presence and felt her. And I feel like now that I know she had Jewish heritage, as I do. And also, I knew that she was also indigenous, as well as myself. And I feel like that was part of our being able to sit and connect without words. So when I heard of her passing, I wanted to honor her with song and the family as well. And so this is a song that I took from a Chinook poem by Chief Gary Johnson, and it's called Show Us the Way. We call upon the earth, our planet, our home, with beautiful heights and abundance of life. And we ask it to teach us and show us the way. We call upon the waters, the rivers and seas, pure waters that fall down on you and me. And we ask the waters to teach us and show us the way. 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 We call upon the forest, the great cedar trees, roots in the earth, the keepers of knowledge, and we ask them to teach us and show us the way. We call upon the creatures, our brothers and sisters, Moolak and Lelu, and the salmon and eagle, and we ask them to teach us and show us the way. We call upon
repeat what a lot of people have said, so I'm cutting a little bit. But I ran across a paper that was written by Caroline for the University of Phoenix that was written in 2006, in which she talked about how she used education to fill in the gaps. And one of her deepest passions that I think Erik talked about was to help homeless youth in Seattle. And she volunteered for that organization that he spoke of called Street Links. And when the leadership changed, they canceled the program, and she got together with many of the volunteers and had hoped to reestablish it. But then they realized that they needed more skills. She said, I needed nonprofit management, and they needed skills in caring for homeless youth. So she went to school and got a degree in human services management. And then when they moved to New Jersey, as you heard, they established a travel, she established a travel agency in an era when women didn't really run travel agencies much. And so she broke the glass ceiling and established this travel agency with a friend and a neighbor named M.W. And that was in 1971. And of course, it availed her of much travel all over the world, which was her passion as well. So then she went back, when they moved back to the Seattle area, she went back to an inner calling that she had received at 10 to become a minister. And in 1978, enrolled in the Ernest Holmes College Seminary that was in Los Angeles, and was ordained as a minister in 1980. She had an extraordinary experience when she was 5 years old. She contracted pneumonia and was given up for dead. I mean, she told me this story personally and felt like she wasn't valued, or nobody really cared if she lived or died. So I think that had a huge impact on her early upbringing and her thinking, which she called her stinking thinking. But she credits her classes at the Ballard Church of Religious Science, her classes in the teachings of Ernest Holmes, which began this whole process of changing her thinking and changing her life. And she writes, it was brought smack up against my erroneous thinking. It was a very painful process. So some of the spiritual principles that she began to apply were that she may never have admitted that she felt inferior to others, but there have been times when all of us have felt timid, shy, fearful about attempting something. And Ernest Holmes wrote, this is evident of a thought pattern deep within you which silently suggested that you were inferior, and you accepted the suggestion. And if you're made in the image and likeness of God, it's impossible to feel inferior, because you are life, love, wisdom, intelligence, peace, creativity, beauty, and joy. And if any previous experience made you feel otherwise, know that these memories are now being cleansed, and you now have dominion over negative thinking. That was written in How to Change Your Life by Ernest Holmes. And Caroline wrote in this paper, as I began to change my thinking, I was able to handle a very personal situation, the impending failure of my marriage of 26 years. She also discovered the path to becoming a minister, and this was a lifelong career. She enrolled in a course from Dale Carnegie to improve her presentations. And I had the opportunity to make a last visit to Caroline the Tuesday before she passed on Friday. And my husband, Mario, asked Caroline to tell us a joke. And she loved to tell jokes. So she said, a new preacher was giving his first sermon at a church. And in old-style homiletics, or the way they teach ministers public speaking, preachers were trained to memorize their talks on Saturday by repeating them about 20 times, and then on Sunday delivering them as if they were doing it extemporaneously. So this was a brand new preacher, and he led off in his talk with, "Behold, I cometh." And then he went totally blank. And he stepped back a couple of feet, and he thought maybe by moving a little, they teach you in theater that if you move, it helps you remember. So he thought if he moved a little bit, he'd remember the rest of it. So he moved back, and he said, "Behold, I come." And then he went blank again. And so finally he stepped back about 6 feet. I'm not going to do it. But he was back about 6 feet, and he ran to the out, and he said, "Behold, I cometh," and he landed on the front row next to an old lady, and he said, "I'm so sorry, please forgive me," and she said, "It's quite all right, you told me you were coming 3 times. Caroline had a great sense of humor, and she enjoyed our laughter, and she then got serious, and she told me she was in so much pain from the arthritis that she suffered from at the end. And it was as though she didn't want to struggle anymore. And so before we left, she gifted me with a print of an owl that hung over her desk. It was by Jody Bergsman, and it was called "Night Eagle Comes, Bringing a Message from the Grandmother." And for those of you who know about the grandmothers, there's about 4 or 6 of them that are out there right now, Native American grandmothers that share their wisdom all over the world. So that was a beautiful gift she gave to me. And I think she also gave us a little, we got to pick which little owl we wanted, which you'll get a chance to do in our communion of owls in just a few minutes. So in her writing, she said, "To me, life is about learning, and I will only stop learning when the dirt is thrown over my coffin, or as I prefer to say, when they pat my face with a shovel." I am determined not to be one of those old ladies who's set in her ways and narrow-minded in outlook. Life is too short to be stuck in a rut. Life, I say, is like a delicious, huge buffet, and I plan to taste as much of it as I can. That was Caroline. She tasted an enormous amount of life. May God rest her soul. And so we're going to hear a healing song from her son, Erik, that's a Chinook song. And I heard him, the reason I asked him to do this was he and Caroline conducted a Native American memorial service here at the church. And I got to hear him sing this, and it was so beautiful, I thought it would be appropriate for you to hear this song of healing at this time.
Okay, so now you're going to put me on the spot. And one more thing I wanted to say, too. I wanted to thank Ronald Edens up in the loft there. Normally we do the AV together. He runs the camera and I run the audio, and it really is a two-person job. It's just barely possible for one person to do it by themselves. And when I told Frances that I was planning to run the audio and just run back and forth, she said, "Absolutely not." So Ronald's up there doing it all himself. So thank you, Ronald. All right, well, I used to be involved in a group called the Red Cedar Circle, but they sort of went into dispersion, and so I haven't been been there in a while, but I had a lot of amazing experiences and friendships with Native American people over the years. And this song was actually given to me by Pauline Hilaire, whose name is Scala. And this comes from her grandfather, Joe Hilaire. And I'm going to do my best. I can't sing and play drums in an apartment, so the neighbors would kill me. So I don't get very many opportunities to sing, but I'll give it a go here. Oh.
We're going to do an owl communion. Towards the end of her life, Caroline loved to share her owl collection. And so we are going to do this way. We're going to start from the back and have you come up the aisle and then take a right turn. And there's a table full of her owl collection. Pick one of them. And then go around on the side of the church back to your seat. And those of you who are on this side will have to go around on the very back row to get to your seat. So so we're going to start. And Terry O'Hara and Benny are going to be playing I'll Fly Away. So it's kind of a meditative process. The symbol of the owl, it not only means death, but it means wisdom and transformation. And I think transformation, it's the perfect and most fitting symbol I can think of for Caroline and her life. And so as you choose an owl, just know that you're choosing a symbol of transformation to take home in memory of Caroline. So we're going to begin, and we'll just keep playing the music until everyone has gotten an owl. So we begin. And now for the commendation. Holy God, I commend the souls and spirits of dear Caroline and beloved Paul Perrault into the most tender place in God's heart. For us, they have gone. Let us be comforted and given the strength to remember they have not gone far, for they are part of the eternal spirit. In the sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life, we commend to Almighty God our beautiful Reverend Caroline and the father of her children, Paul Perrault. The Lord bless them and keep them. The Lord make his face shine upon them and be gracious to them. The Lord lift his countenance upon them and give them peace. And so it is. Amen. And to give our closing prayer is Practitioner Suzanne Frazier. So if you choose to close your eyes, and just for a moment, bring Caroline's face forward. What do you notice? What do you notice? I know that God occupies every space. I know that God is right here in the midst of us right now. She was fully present. She listened. And she listened without words. Caroline was a true pioneer in many ways. She was a mother to many, a friend to many. And she will be missed, but only if we allow it. Because I know that she is here. I know that she's with us at any moment we choose. Our loved ones are always within our hearts. There's an old, a first friend of mine that once gave me, I was working with a dying person, and I was grieving. And an Iroquois woman that happened to be in the support group I was there with told me that when someone dies, we think about them going away from us, leaving us, and in reality, they remain with us, and we go on with them. The love remains. The love is always there. We need only call on it when we want it to make us smile, to make us remember. And those of us that were fortunate enough to have conversation with Caroline, if you ever sat in a visioning experience with Caroline, it was fabulous. It was fabulous. She was a dear, sweet person. And my thoughts for her at this time is during the time of her release that she was accompanied not just by angels, but she was borne up on the wings of owls, owls and angels, and she remains there and is available, and God bless her. Sweet Caroline, I'm so grateful, and I just say thank you, dear sweet spirit, and so it is. So please join in singing Spirit in the Sky. The words are in your program.
I love this choice. When I die, place at the best, when I lay me down and die, going up to the spirit in the sky, going up to the spirit in the sky, where I'm gonna go when I die and they lay me to rest, gonna go to the place at the best.
invited to a reception that's going to be downstairs. And so we invite you to go. And but before you go, we're going to listen to one of Caroline's favorite songs from Dr. Zhivago, played by Benny and Terry, called Lara's Song. And afterwards, be sure and enjoy the displays. I think there's some of the sculpture that Erik's dad did, as well as other photographs. They're just on display up here. And you can either eat downstairs or you can bring your food up to the sanctuary and spread out. So, we ask that you let the family go downstairs first. And then all of you can come down and enjoy our reception. So thank you, Benny and Terry, for the music.
Thank you.
going to invite the family to go downstairs, and everyone else will meet and greet you down there.